Hey everyone, it's Pitiku from Rock Daydream Nation, and I've got Pete Jones back to the channel. How are you, my friend?
I'm wonderful, Peter. Thank you. Great to be here for another round of Deep Purple.
Absolutely. So it's an ongoing series between me and Pete. We're just exploring the Deep Purple family tree. And this time we're going to go to 1993, which was the very final Mark II album by Deep Purple, and that is The Battle Rages On. So that's my CD and the album. So the album didn't come out on vinyl in the day, but this was reissued much, much later. So we're going to talk about our opinion of the album in the day, spotlight songs, track listing, and then give our 2024 opinion. So Pete, as usual, what was your opinion of this album in 1993?
You know, it was favorable, Peter. And, you know, I had gone through all of the various albums since the Perfect Strangers. And please, people, go watch our previous shows because we've got a lot to mention on that album specifically. You know, they'd taken a little bit of a right turn with Jolyn Turner. You know, that's a story for a complete another day. You know, whether your preferences were positive or negative, what we have here is the return, like you said, of Mark II. I was excited for it, and I had a positive reaction to it. I enjoyed it. And as we get further into this more specifically, you'll see why. But I thought it was a strong return and was really glad that it was there.
Okay. Well, my recollection of hearing this album for the first time was that there were probably two really strong tracks and the rest of it didn't quite get traction with me. So The Battle Rages On, which is the epic first track, and we'll talk about that very shortly. And the other song, which was the other epic song on the album, Anya. Now, 1993 was pretty strange times for classic rock, metal, hard rock. The sands were definitely shifting. You had alternative rock, you had grunge, all these different types of genres that were sweeping those sort of genres aside, so to speak. So Deep Purple coming back in Mark II in 1993 was definitely a much more less favorable climate than 1984.
No, I agree.
I remember going to my local record store, big chain, HMV, and Deep Purple promotion for this album was buried. So literally in 1984, where the real estate would be huge, you'd have big posters, you'd have the big placards of all the different members of the band. Seeing it in 1993, it was the real estate was just one little corner of a stand. Right. So it definitely got buried. I cannot remember seeing any promotional photos of any of the members of the band. And even when you look at the album, Pete, you know, the insert, there's no photos. So it was very low key. I don't remember seeing a video in regards to it. So
no,
reading our magazines in the day, like your Kerrang! Trade magazines, that's the way I was keeping up to date, that there was Mark II was back, and it was becoming a bit of a soap opera. You know, Jolyn Turner out, Gillan in, and I'm going, okay, what's happening here?
Right.
So there was a fair amount of drama. But anyway, getting back to this album, my first impressions, two big songs had a bit of traction. The rest, it didn't really sort of click with me. And to be quite frank, over a considerable period of time, you know, the subsequent years, I didn't really play this album much. I always went to my favorites in the Deep Purple discography.
Right.
So
right.
It is what it is. So why don't we go one track at a time, do a bit of a deep dive. So let's start off with track one on the album, Battle Rages On.
If I may, can I throw in just a tiny bit of more back history here on this piece?
Yes.
You know, you mentioned it, and it was a kind of a strange, tumultuous time because Slaves and Masters came out, and that reached 87 and here, which was a far drop from House of Blue Light, was at 34. Now, Jolin Turner is actually in the band when they start pre-production here. He's there and he is their lead singer. And pressure starts to mount from external sources. From what I've read, management was getting involved with this because they were coming up on the 25th anniversary of the band. And they were pushing to move on from that. But Turner gets fired, and in comes Mike DeMeo, if I pronounce his name correctly. And I had no idea who he was on any level going through this until I went back and realized that he had joined Riot after his very, very, very brief stint as the Deep Purple singer. And I guess there were demos that were done, but they've never been released. And it's interesting because, you know, say, well, what in the world would that have sounded like if you go back and listen to the Riot material? All you have to do is go back to the first album that he did when he joined Riot in 93, Nightbreaker. There's a cover of Burn, which he does. And with all due respect, a solid singer, but I was definitely not a fan of that. So I can kind of wipe my brow and go, phew. Averted yeah. crisis, because I do not think he would have been a good choice.
I'll put up my hand and give you my theory. I think that the record label was really pushing hard. You've got to get Gillan back for the 25th anniversary. And yeah. Blackers was holding out. No.
Absolutely.
Because it was absolutely deadly toxic between those two. Right. I mean, Blackmore was the instigator to have Gillan fired out of the band, get Jolin Turner in. And the record company was, you know, leveraging and saying, basically, you get Gillan back in the band or there's no record. Right. There was also some other skin in the game. I think they were giving the extra inducement of another Rainbow album. So I think that was the thing that got Blackmore back into the line. So I think this extra singer was Blackmore say, okay, we won't have Jolin Turner. How about we get this singer in?
How about we get this guy? Right.
And it
right.
just didn't, and it just didn't work out. So right. eventually Gillan comes into it. Can you imagine what it would have felt like for Gillan to come back? I think the rest of the band was quite warm, an old friend coming back in. But can you imagine what it would have felt like? You're going back into an environment, a working environment, where somebody just does not want you there.
Well, you know, it's interesting, Peter, because we've seen this story before. And we saw that when Blackies decided that Ian had kind of quit. He had quit on his own, but he's like, well, Roger's got to go too. And Roger didn't do anything wrong. He's Switzerland. He never bothers anybody, you know, and Lord and Pacey were very passive about it. They have regrets later on saying that shouldn't have happened and we should have stood up a bit more. And here we are in a similar situation where somehow the band stands up to Blackmore and says, mm-mm, we need Gillan. And they bring Gillan back. And I think even at that point, it's got to be even worse because Richie may have felt he could have maybe swayed Lord and Pacey a bit. But it doesn't appear that's the case here anymore. And, you know, it doesn't take long. It's not, you only get as far as November 17th of 93. Blackmore plays their last show and he plays the show in Helsinki and he's done. And we've never seen him since.
Yeah, he's absolutely
gone.
Yeah. Well, I think the band were triggered into action because the Slaves and Master tour was not a success. Look, they were selling quite decently in Europe, especially Europe, Eastern
yes.
Europe,
yeah.
Eastern US, Europe, which is a big market, but US market. The size of the theaters had shrunk. So I'll give you a comparison. 84, where they did the reunion, they're playing Madison Square Garden venues, huge mm-hmm. venues.
Right.
Barely selling out Radio City Music Hall in New York on the Slaves and Masters. And a lot of their concert halls got cancelled because of the poor ticket sales. So, the band was spurred into action. They had to do something. It just was not working. Anyway.
So, we get to the album. And in contrast, this reaches 192 in the US. That's awful. Awful.
Yeah.
And some other ones later on don't chart at all, but it's a different world in how they chart things. But that is a very swift drop off. 34 to 87 to 192.
Yeah, well, I think it's the musical climate. I think it's because the label, BMG, was not pushing. And I think it's also to do that the album cover is, in my opinion, quite ordinary.
I don't like the logo at all. Give me that classic Deep Purple logo. That would have helped. It's that flashy.
It's anonymous. It's anonymous. It could be like a Jethro Tull album. You know how Jethro Tull, those sort of albums they were doing in the 90s. Right. But how is this band going to get another audience? It was just so low key. I think that it's like the label was just concentrating on their golden children, which is the what was been happening at the time. And this is some heritage act, and just let it wither on the vine.
Well, and then just a real quick synopsis here. I wrote down this funny comment. At least it sounded funny to me. When you get to the production of this record, I go, my goodness, there's more producers and engineers on this than a Beyonce track. I mean, holy smokes. Now, it breaks down to two main guys. Roger is there, but Roger's got help this time from Tom, and I will never pronounce this right, Panozio. And you got to look him up, folks, because this is not a one-trick pony. This guy has a legacy, a long legacy of producing, mixing, engineering, and he did the basic tracks here, which is important is when I talk about my descriptions. But we've got five different engineers over three different studios and mixed by Roger and a gentleman, Pat Regan, who was one of the engineers on one of the sessions. And thank goodness it was mastered by Mr. George Marino at Sterling Sound because he's amazing. so, you know, if we jump into this, we get, like you said, the battle rages on at 5:56. A big, powerful track opens with a super unison tight punches into a real driving riff from the band. And the absolute first thing that hits me, Pete, is the sound of this. It's huge. It's very powerful and very thick. Blackmore and Lord fire off this great riff, and they're just perfectly balanced, both from a panning perspective and a mixing perspective. Gillan enters with harmonies right from the very beginning on the first verse with Lord's very huge organ underneath it, which is sounds like home to me. It's also a beautiful compositional choice that Richie doesn't play at the beginning of the first parts of the verse. He drops out. So it's everybody but him. And then he comes back with the opening riff to connect back to the next verse, drops out again, and they get to this pre-chorus section where he's like, oh, don't talk to me of love, where Lord is just firing away. And Richie is right there with him with these unison licks. And like, oh my God, it's super tight and sounds really great. In the chorus, Blackmore pulls his guitar way back sonically and almost plays like this kind of Niles Rogers, like strummy guitar with no distortion. I think it's a very interesting choice, but it's effective. Gillan's voice is big, and it's really held together by the rhythm section with Lord supporting it. We go back to the opening riff, which again now sounds even heavier for some reason. And then in the nice choice, we get to the next series of verses. Blackmore doesn't drop out this time. So now it's gotten a little bit bigger and sounds strong. To me, Ian Pace sounds like a powerhouse here. His drums just sound enormous. His bass drum is a cannon. And while not nearly as he was in his youth, his speed and dexterity here is on full display, which I was very excited to hear. You know, another chorus, we go on, and here's where everything just starts to gel for me. The solo section, Blackmore just unleashes. It's just this full arsenal of technique and chops, and everything's on display here. Drums pick up a bit. The underlying tracks behind them are very exciting and provide a lot of support. And it just keeps building and building and building to this final chorus. Pacey's toms are clean. You've got good pitch differential between them when he goes around the kit. Then as they start to come to the end, Blackmore just chugs away. And then the whole orchestra as an ensemble builds, and a snare fill. Bam! I'm like, hello. I love this track, Peter. I think it's a great opener and one of their more solid in a long, long time, I think.
Well, mate, the way you describe that song, it sounds like the song's really compelling, but unfortunately, I have a different opinion.
Go for it.
So when you hear the lyrics, was it love or hate that got here first? Hate's a habit. It's hard to shake the curse. Man, this is such a maudlin song to start off an album, because Deep Purple have a specialty of having a bright, bubbly, cracking rock song, sort of, you know, pow, punches. This song kind of plods along. Look, there's a little bit of push and pull. There's a little bit of build up. But to me, it's too mid-paced. It's too, you know, sedentary. I don't know. There's something about it that doesn't sort of groove with me. I notice that Richie is slightly getting into the Eastern Egypto
a little bit,
yep. You know, that he loves mining that. Gillan's vocals. I like Gillan to be singing a little bit more pure and not the triple tracking.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
we'll talk about this as we go deep into this album. I don't think the producer knows what to do with Gillan's vocals. Now, we've discussed that Gillan may have had problems. But there's all sorts of processing of his voice. I want to hear Gillan, one track, the pure Gillan voice. And if this may be the problem with the material, because a lot of the tracks were laid, a lot of the songs were written for Jolene Turner in mind. Right. Gillan has come into it later, and that's a problem. When a singer comes into a project and the songs haven't been written for you or arranged for you, then there could be some issues. So perhaps, you know, the music was laid and it was in a key that didn't suit Gillan. But I'm not really comfortable with the triple tracking of Gillan. It's all over the shop. Now, the drum sound, clank, that's the word I've used. There's this real heavy clanking. I think the mix on this song is way too loud. And the way it's mixed is a 1993 mix, an alternative rock mix. It hasn't got that warm analog Deep Purple sound.
No, it doesn't.
Even Perfect Strangers with the Meat and Potatoes, Roger Glover mix, which are, you know, I sometimes throw pot shots as not being terribly imaginative, has a warmer sound. This one is kind of really sort of in your face. I've played it on CD, I've played it on vinyl, I've played it all week, but to me, it's just way too loud. But getting back to the song, if you want the first song, it's got to be like a highway star, it's got to be like a burn, it's got to be a cracker. And this song is basically talking about the battle rages on, you know, it's sort of a metaphor for the woes and the issues we're having in the band. It's not a good start for the listener. It's very maudlin. And, I don't quite see it the way that you see it, Pete, but I really appreciate your opinion because, you know, you're picking things in, you know, that just it's a different take, I guess.
Which is a beautiful thing. contrast and comparisons. You know, I think it would be a very boring world if you and I agreed on absolutely everything, Peter.
Yeah, I just don't think it fires on all cylinders. It's just a song that needs a little bit more. And a criticism I have with this album is there's a lot of padding. This is a very long Deep Purple album, 54 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
So, all right, well, let's go to track two. The next song is Lick It Up.
Well, you know, I'm going to echo some of the things that you said, and I was going to save it till the end, but I think it's important to raise it right now, that there is kind of a disconnect at a fundamental level here over the course of this whole record for me. My musician side of me is so over the moon and enthralled with it musically. I can't get enough of it. I just can't get enough of it. But the vocals in a lot of cases don't blend well. They don't mix well, either from a melodic standpoint, a production standpoint, or in some of the tracks, both melodic and implementation. And and that's kind of the knock on it. But as a musician guy first, I'll get to the lyrics a bit later and I'll get down the line. And if I don't like the music, I'm not really interested in what he's saying to begin with, but I'm kind of clinging and holding on to that aspect of it. When we get to Lick It Up, you know, a nice tight snare drum roll from Pace brings it in, and Blackmore is playing this really thick and just overly distorted. And it's another slow track. It's another mid to slower tempo. His tone is so focused. It's like a laser cutting through the atmosphere. And for my ears, it just works. And Pacey holds it tight with this really nice groove. Full band joins in and brings a nice full level to it. The verses here are a little better for me because here he does this first verse as a single line only. There are no doubling. There are no extra track, multi-layering, and there's no harmonies. And I think his voice sounds strong, and I think it works. We get to the pre-chorus. It's not too long. Here comes the extra vocal lines. And Pacey gets a bit more funky, which I love. His drumming is creative here. And then they get to the chorus. Now the chorus is really just a restatement of the opening riff with him singing over the top of it. The band's really driving, but I think he could have done more with the chorus a little bit to kind of differentiate it from that section. It's a very strange solo section because they're really not playing anything melodic or riff-based. It's kind of a series of noises that move through the chord progression until we finally hear one of Gillan's proper screams come out of it back into the chorus. And that goes back to another strange kind of solo section, and in the middle of it, Pacey throws this halftime triplet feel that just comes out of left field, and I enjoyed that, but you're like, I was not expecting that. You know, it's a different kind of song musically. I am loving how heavy it is, and it's got a lot of power and energy. But the vocal part is a bit unsettling, and the solo section was weird. So yeah, it's kind of a strange tune.
No, I like that because you sound very conflicted. On one hand,
yeah,
musically, the chops, you love it, but
absolutely,
there's something that just kind of doesn't quite get you there, fair to right. say. Yeah. Gillan's voice sounds more like Ian Gillan. However, mm-hmm. he's taking on a different character, so there's a lot of different character intonations that Gillan's doing. And I'm just wondering, throughout the course of this project where he's trying to find his voice, he is figuring it out. As I said, you've got to understand, he's parachuted into a band. One person doesn't like him. project has been laid out, all the blueprint prior to his entry into this project, must be very disconcerting. So it feels like all these different things that he's working with the producer just to get the right sound.
Would you presume, based on writing credits, Peter, that Gillan reworked all the vocal harmonies and melodies?
I think so, absolutely.
Unlike Tony Martin, who basically, I don't want to say copied because that's a horrible word, reproduced what Ray Gillan had already done on Eternal Idol.
Absolutely. I think he's reworked it. And Jolene Turner's had a pot shot at Ian Gillan reworking the vocal lines and the lyrics. You're like, one man's meat. Oh, how English is that? We'll talk about that later.
Right, sure.
But I don't like the way that Gillan's voice is mixed. It's very much buried. That's another criticism I have in the production of the mix of this album. It's not really putting a spotlight on Gillan.
It's instrument forward.
Yeah, it just doesn't know where to place him in the mix. So I find that quite distracting. It's a simple note riff. It sounds very familiar. You and I have spoken offline many times that Richie's a recycler. So, I mean, if you're going to recycle, recycle from the best. So it sounds very familiar. Again, the drums are a bit clanky and loud. I've got no dispute. Pace, I love his drumming, but I just think the mix, it's just very noisy and it's a little bit clanky for the song. So, look, I don't think it's a startling second track. So far, track two, I'm not sold. Anyway.
More than Anya, fair.
Anya, number three. This was the next single. I think it was, or maybe the first or second single off the album. What do you think of this track, Pete?
I love this track, Peter. It's the longest track on the album. Opens with a beautifully played and recorded acoustic guitar interlude from Blackmore, with very, very subtle but supportive keys underneath, until Lord kind of takes the lead with a little harpsichord-like old kind of Baroque stylistic keyboard, which is very beautifully done. And it is very clean recorded wise. Then all of a sudden this thing kind of explodes into these huge power chord where Blackmore plays the opening riff twice by himself. And then the third and fourth time Lord kicks in. So it just gets bigger as the instrumentation adds. Main riff kicks in. It's, again, a medium tempo, and it kind of just pushes like crazy. And then Gillan starts the verse, which I think sounds really, really great. This is familiar territory to my ears. It's clean and classic in its delivery and style, and I think his vocals are better produced and represented here than they may have been on the first two tracks. I think the pre-chorus is dark and brooding. I think when he goes to the hidden passions, touching a spark with the unison, bam, bam. I mean, it just musically is really exciting. And when you get to the gypsy heart, here we go to a very heavy halftime. And that just feels really, really good and aggressive. And then, boom, right back into the main riff. The problem I have with Gillan here is that it's something that he does quite a bit, and I'll mention it on other tracks as well, so I'll kind of just throw a blanket around all of them. He's doing a lot of sliding in and out of the... He's all over the place. He's not focusing on a pitch, hitting it, doing what he's going to do with it. You know, I mean, Anya to him must have 15 syllables because he's just all over the place, which kind of makes it a weird kind of unstable moving target, which sonically to my ears is a little bit off. So I'm not a big fan of that. We get back to the driving section. Glover sounds great on this. He's thundering underneath. Repeat the verse, the pre-chorus, no problem. Blackmore fires off a spectacular solo in this. This is just vintage Richie. And again, I'm gonna keep saying this, Peter, the tone and the edge and the cut that comes off of his guitar is just heavenly to me. It just connects. I couldn't explain it. It's just something that works. We go back to the opening motif, and this time Lord takes the lead on the riff. Then Blackmore joins him, which is a nice reversal of the roles when they introduced the riff the first time. Back to the pre-chorus, tight chokes from the band while the riff fires underneath. It's an impressive wall of sound until it finally resolves and we get a kind of a restatement of the light little harpsichord-like conclusion from Lord. You know, this is a song style that Richie would revisit. This has elements all over Stranger in Us All. This kind of writing is very prominent in that record when he goes back to do his Rainbow album. I enjoy the track quite a bit, and I listen to this one a lot.
Yeah. Have you heard the radio edit of this song? Because this song is 10 minutes and the radio edit is much more truncated. Have you ever come across that? Yeah. No. Yeah. But I think that's the problem that Deep Purple have with some of these longer songs that when you hear the radio edit, it chops out a lot of very important musical passages. But knocking at your back door is very disconcerting when you hear the radio edit of that, where they knock out a lot of the music. But look, the big problem I have with this song is too much padding. It's 10 minutes. It's way too long. So you've got that nice little flamenco piece of Richie Blackmore. It's 56 seconds before it gets into, you know, the next development musical passage to move things along. I agree with you. I wrote this down about Ian Gillan. Vocally, his phrasing is all over the place and it's sliding all over the place. And I think what he's doing is he's vocally recalling that Perfect Strangers chorus where he's doing that sort of Eastern mysticism type of singing. But he does this all the way through this song, and I think it's way, way too much. He's just pushing it too much. I'm not a big fan of this song. I think it's too much padding. It reminds me of Strange Ways from the House of Blue Light, which is another song that just goes on way, way too long. It just doesn't go anywhere. I don't know. I don't really emotionally connect to this song. This song, I just think it would have been a lot better if it was around about 4 to 5 minutes. I'm sorry, I don't emotionally connect to this song.
That's more than fair. More than fair. All very valid and well thought out points there, Peter. Talk about love, right?
Yeah.
It's another tight opening musically. With Blackmore playing another very, very heavy riff. They leave a lot of space in this one. It breathes a little more. It's not more of a string of consciousness of notes. It's got a little more, like I said, openness to it. Pacey's is real strong and direct on this. The verses are very heavy and well done. We get to Gillan, and I think he's strong here. I do think that there are tiny little hints and flavors of sections of Cut Runs Deep on here, which isn't surprising when we remind ourselves that Jolyn was there first. So we don't know how much of that carried over. The chorus isn't my favorite vocally, but the music and accompaniment is great. And I had mentioned Gillan's sliding around too much. Another strong solo section. I think as a whole, the band, mostly it's Richie and John, are very, very strong here. They're very competent. These are very mature, technically sound, very creative solos. And they just sound really great. You know, another round of verses, choruses. Let me get back to here, back to the chorus, some more tasty stuff from Pacey. They get back to the opening riff and kind of end it out. It's short, it's concise. This one's a little more restrained from a compositional standpoint. It doesn't allow it to kind of meander, which I appreciate. I didn't care for this one early on. Also, the other thing I want to mention, Peter, is that with Gillan, not only is he kind of sliding around a bit, I feel like he's pinching. But what I mean is like, everything's got a kind of a nasal front of the lobe squeezing of the vowels or the consonants, which can come off a tiny bit whiny as opposed to open and rich tones that certainly he was much more known for in his younger days. The combination of the sliding with the more nasality to it can be a little bit off-putting and kind of hard to wrap around like a warm blanket. Even though he may be singing something nice and it's maybe a good melody, technically from an execution standpoint, it's a little more challenged. And I think that's something that also is pervasive through many of the tracks on this record.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, look, I think he pushes it too hard. And I don't think it's his fault. I just think it's just the way that the tracks were laid. They were arranged. He's come into something. If there was more time, maybe they should have gone back to the drawing board and said, okay, are you comfortable with this key? Do we need to, you know, put it in a different key that is more attuned with your vocal range? I just think that, he's adapting to what the material was instead of the band considering that we've got a new vocalist and we may need to adjust the material to him.
Right.
I just think the dynamics are slightly wrong there. I like this song. I didn't in the time, but I've grown to warm to this song a lot. It's got a little bit of a Zeppelin feel to it, just the basic riff. One thing I wanted to talk to you about is Deep Purple and the groove. Now, one thing I'm always been pushing the barrow for is Deep Purple have a natural groove. Mm-hmm. Strange Kind of Woman. You know, those sort of songs, Demon's Eye, where it's just Pacey's drumming. It's in the pocket and there's just a natural groove. Yes. A lot of these songs, there's a shaker or a maraca and it kind of adds a fake faux groove to the songs. So it's as if the song has been put together and it's sort of very four on the floor, meat and potatoes. And they think, oh, we've got to bring something in to give it a little bit more of a bit of a groove to it. Let's put a maraca in. You know, is that something, you know, did you notice that?
Yeah, quite a bit. It's there. It's pretty prevalent. You know, it's interesting because what it can do is, and I don't know if by this time, you know, they're using click tracks. I would maybe think, I mean, I would think so. Maybe by 93, you might be using click tracks. Purple's always kind of avoided it. It wasn't their thing. But it creates a metronomic pulse that is unwavering. And you say, well, that's a good thing, Pete. Well, no, it's not always. Because sometimes you like a track to breathe and kind of push and pull a bit. And you can say, well, you can play maracas to a non-click track. Yeah, you can. But the way it's mixed and the way it's used, it does kind of take over, let's say, what Pacey's hi-hat is doing. It becomes an alternative to that. We've still got plenty of kick and we've got plenty of snare. But as you said, that is a very straightforward meat and potatoes, backbeat, rock and roll kind of thing. It still has Pacey's lilt to it. So it's not boxy. It's not square. It's not going to be that ever because he doesn't know how to play that way. He can't. But if you take the drum kit and you take his hi-hat out and replace it with a shaker or a similar percussion thing, the kit sounds different. And I think that that shaker replaces his hi-hat a bit, which kind of makes it a little bit, you know, FAUX. It's it's a little bit.
Yeah, I just, that was the thing that sort of stuck with me. There's this faux groove, and that's another sort of negative that I have for this album. They've kind of lost their groove. They're very much in the, a little bit boxy, even though Pacey kind of goes a little bit outside the parameters. But it's sort of like they've had to add these little embellishments to show, hey, you know, we haven't lost our groove. There's, you know, let's get a little bit more groove element in here and we'll put a maraca or a shaker on. But look, getting back to this track, I like it. It's one of the stronger ones on the album. So there you go, folks. I'm not a total negative Nancy on all of this album. I don't mind this track at all.
No apologies ever needed, sir. You be you. You know, Time to Kill, another kind of a medium tempo. This is another basic two beat, you know, kick on one and three, snare drum on two and four. That's, you know, I think the instruments are strong. There's a lot of power and energy there. And it kind of sits well. During the verse, Richie and John have a kind of a, this vicious backing instrumental section underneath the lyric, which I think is really cool. And same in the pre-chorus. This song, more than the one I had mentioned before, this is every time he says the word kill, it's kill, it's squeezed. Time to kill. It's not, the consonant is being almost morphed into a more vowel-like tone. And is that easier for him to sing at that stage? Because our mouths form differently for consonants than we do vowels. And maybe he's modifying that a bit. But, and that always sounds like, and this is going to sound really strange considering who he is, all singers have a break point in their natural voice. That point is where they either need to go out of their chest into either the head, the falsetto, or some kind of mix. The pitches that he's using on this chorus are sitting right at that apex of where that break is. So he's trying to deliver it with full power, and it's a little bit stretched and kind of squeezed. It's not as rich or as, let's say, at home. Because then if he goes into a different range and goes into the higher stuff, and that's what's funny about singers like him. You can have this really rich, nice, beautiful low to mid-tone. And at the same time, he can do what he was doing on Born Again and then just crush and break glass. But it's that middle section. How does his voice sit there? Where is it comfortable? It doesn't sound comfortable here. You know, and this breaks down, and this has a brilliant organ solo from John, a long time coming. It's, you know, how many tracks are we in before we really get a good standalone organ solo? Too many, in my opinion. We should have heard something earlier on. You know, it's just, like I said, Gillan's delivery isn't my favorite, and he kind of does his best Bob Dylan impression. He's kind of mumbling through the words a bit, and that's not very Ian Gillan-ish, in my opinion.
Well, I think we're coming up with a bit of a common theme here as we go deeper into the tracks. So, Ian Gillan. It sounds very underdeveloped, this song. I think it needed to be figured out a little bit more. And Blackmore's notorious. Couple of takes. Well, firstly, let's rehearse it. Couple of takes, done. On to the next thing. He's a guy with a very short attention span. This goes for a bit of an American-orientated rock sound, Pete. So I think they were looking for something that was a little bit more slower paced, that could be played on radio, a bit more radio-friendly. This is not the classic 70s Deep Purple sound that I like. Yeah, I just think this song needed to be worked a little bit more. And yeah, look, vocally, it just comes down to the thing that we've been talking about all the way through. He's come to this material and he's trying to adapt to it, and he's stretching his voice into all these different tangents, and not all of it's working. I think this is a bit of a filler track and not one of the strongest ones on the album.
I'll throw an earworm out there for people. When you go back and listen to this chorus again, superimpose the lyrics to Hammer to Fall by Queen. And
yes. It does. Absolutely.
Sorry to do that to you.
Hello, Blackers.
Yeah. So, Ramshackle Man, sir.
Green Onions.
That's what I wrote, Mr. Booker T, right? A heavy triplet unison pattern with Blackmore soloing over the top of it. And then once that Lord riff kicks in, you're right, it's Green Onions. And, you know, it's interesting because you've got that on one side, but Richie, it keeps getting more and more aggressive in his tone as we're going through the record. It's just, I can only imagine what volume he was playing at in the studio at the time. You know, to get that kind of wickedly natural oversaturation that he has, but yet he's so good at controlling it, and he can still play so musically with it, which is, man, that's hard to do. Nugent was the other guy who could just play, you know, you give him his guitar to 99% of the other guitarists, they can't play two notes because it just starts beating back and they don't know what the hell to do with it. But Richie really kind of nails this here. The verses are relatively strong, and I love, there's a little homage in there, Peter. They do the running from Black Knight. They do the chord progression as it runs through there, which I think is kind of nice. And I'm like, that's a pretty good thing. But what do we have here? We have really our first shuffle, you know, and it's familiar for Purple fans. It's nice to have that finally. And the keys are a little bit more pronounced and aggressive here. You get back to an opening triplet feel with Lord filling in this time, and another nice scream from Gillan. So I guess he can still do it, at least, you know, when the tape says red light, do it, mate. And another great proper solo from Mr. Lord, which sounds really, really great. And this is kind of more of a throwback feel. And I even love that they have a tiny little break where he makes one hand swipe across his keys. And I'm like, that's nice too. So there's kind of another little, you know, little trinket in there, or, you know, Easter egg or something that's in there for us. You know, there's harmonica that now starts to show up in the background a little bit here and there. It's not very pronounced. I mean, it's there. And I'm like, if you're going to do it, use it. Bring it up front and let us hear it. In the back, it's just kind of, it sounds like a mistake. I mean, it's intentional, but if we're going to hear it, let's hear it. You know, I make the notes here to my ears, again, how, at least from an instrumental standpoint, how all of the four instrumentalists are blending very well together as an ensemble sonically. And they're really playing their asses off. You know, and we go back to another triplet, and now it's Blackmore's turn, and where he just starts firing again. And he reintroduces some of those Dio era rainbow licks and styles that he's got in there. So this track is kind of, you know, it's like you're driving by an old neighborhood and you're like, oh, I remember that store, and I remember shopping there, and I remember that grade school. And you're like, these little tastes of familiarity that kind of go in there amongst this kind of very straightforward, shuffly, you know, kind of a tune. I enjoy it. It's a nice change of pace, certainly from the heavy 2-4 that we've been getting for the majority of the album. And Gillan against, like I said, sounds a little bit forced. But he's still got a lot of power. It's not undifferent if we go back and listen to some of his singing on Born Again. He pushed a lot there too. I mean, but he was in control as he was there for the material. And that may be the biggest difference that we're talking about here. Because he had the ability to shape what was going on around it and everything else. And we're presuming that he didn't have that here. So I think it's a fun track. I enjoyed it.
Yeah. Look, I wonder if a producer has ever worked with Gillan and give him some actual vocal advice, or somebody has worked with him and said, hey, maybe this song you need to tone it down a little bit. Ramshackle Man, I just sort of feel that maybe Deep Purple have run out of ideas because they're mining a lot of the old classic rock riffs with Green Onions. I mean, yeah, it's nice. They're looking at their inspirations, their musical inspirations, but is it musically innovative? Not really. It's just a, I don't know. I'm just thinking, is this whole project, a lot of the riffs seem like they've been recycled, whether they're going back into their material of the 70s, whether it's going through the 80s. There's even a little bit of Rainbow filled. I'm just wondering, are they starting to run out of ideas here? It's got a little bit of a groove to it. But to me, that's the thing that was prevailing over this album. And it's sort of, I just didn't sort of connect with this particular song because I'm just thinking that it's too overtly familiar. I mean, we're in track six and you're thinking that, you know, there's sort of this prevailing fear that, you know, Deep Purple have maybe used up all their riffs. I'm not sure.
Entirely possible.
Twist in the Tail.
This is by far my favorite track on the album, by a wide margin. Opens up with a nice big power chord, and then the band just unleashes into this, the first real up-tempo track, where Blackmore and Lord are just in lockstep. They are of a single mind, and they're just firing off these rapid fire riffs. And this is Pacey at his best. They have a slight break and then boom, right in. And I said, you know, it's a busy and impressive pattern and the track moves with authority. It's like a freight train with its tail on fire. And really nobody really did those kind of up-tempo tracks better than Pacey did. You know, his nickname all through the 70s was Speedy. You know, there's a reason. This guy's chops are insane. And, you know, even at this stage of his career, he is firing away. You know, we get into the verse. And while this one is much more spot on for me, the melody is strong. Gillan sounds great. His delivery is focused. The words he's using, the diction that he's using, there's no sliding. He's not pinching off the ends of the vowels. You know, I think it's just great. And when they get to the chorus, it's just so driving. And I think Gillan just sounds amazing. They go back and in the verses, you know, if you listen to what Pacey's doing underneath, it's just so complex, but simple, but it just drives and drives. And that foot of his on his bass drum is a blur. They get through and they repeat the verse and the chorus. And then they get to my favorite moment of this entire album, Peter. They get to a bridge section, right before that. The band kind of breaks down and they start to build dun 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 dun, and then Pacey, bless his heart, fires off one of those patented single stroke snare drum rolls that just made me smile like crazy. It's just starts dun, 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 and off they went. And it just, it's so energetic and so strong. And it, the bridge comes out into brilliant solo sections. Blackmore is just crushing it and ends with a really kind of nice but very short pitch dive. Boom, right back into the verse. And it really works great. They break down more unison sections where Lord and Blackmore are exchanging the riffs back and forth and they're doing them in unison. And then it breaks down with a quarter note kicks and it's kind of sparse with snare hits and some china. And then it just kind of fades out and works nicely. My side note is I preferred the live ending because they go back and do a nice super tight ending, which kind of marries how tight the intro was. But this is one of their best tracks. And when I say best tracks, I'm not qualifying it in the 90s or in the 80s. This is just one of their best tracks. It's a great, great song, in my opinion. I absolutely love this.
Well said, Pete. Reminds me of the House of Blue Light, Dead or Alive. So you can imagine that this song, the embryo was out of a jam. So they're just jamming, putting ideas together, and then press play. and basically the tape's being rolled and it works from there. I think it's a little bit loose. It doesn't sound like it's fully formed, not fully worked out, but there is a certain amount of energy and verve, a little bit more passion, a little bit more fire in the belly than any of the other tracks on the album. So I will grant you. And they're playing as a unit. Very much tight. Again, I've got those reservations about Gillan's tonality. You know, it swirls in here and swirls in there and it's filling in the gaps. Not quite comfortable.
It says the word hard. You know, instead of saying hard, he goes hard.
He pitch bends
all over on a single syllable.
Yeah.
Which is different.
And another observation, track 7, you're finally hearing Lordy playing a very kind of more of a dominant role, because John Lord's role has always been as a faux rhythm guitarist on the keys, you know?
Right.
It's been a very John Lord the Void album comparative to the 70s and the 80s, especially like House of Blue Light. You heard a lot more John Lord. He's experimenting with all these different synthesizers for better or worse. But on this album, it's kind of more stripped back. I wouldn't use the word garage rock with Deep Purple, but it's a bit more of a garage sound, a little bit more. They're stripping back all the embellishments. But that's another thing. You know, I want more John Lord, and you're finally hearing a little bit more of him on this particular song. They're playing as a unit. Yeah, it's got a little bit more energy. But gee whiz, Pete, you know, we're talking about track 7. You're going real deep into the album. Anyway,
right.
That's just my personal. All right, Nasty Piece of Work.
This one is really a grower for me. At first, I wasn't sure. Over time, I wasn't sure. But the heavy revisit, man, I've been playing the absolute crap out of this. You know, this in my ears starts very old school purplish to me. The riff, tonality wise, accoutrement aside and everything else that goes around, if I'm isolating and just listening to Richie, it's got Bloodsucker kind of feel to it for me all the way back to In Rock, and anything that conjures up that is okay with me. It's slow, but you know what? It's nasty and it's really dirty. And I mean both of those in the highest complimentary way. They're just, oh my God, they're so aggressive. And out of this, and Purple's not really the slower, and I'm not going to use doomy because it's not doomy, but you know, they're not usually that band, but they're doing it, and Pacey's keeping it all together and he's keeping it tight. And then out of this big kind of crazy wall of sound, you know, this scream from Gillan just kind of gets faded in, you know, and off it reaches this apex as they go into these verses. And this is all just kind of aggression to me. It's just, you know, the verses are power and they sound kind of mammoth. I just can't get past the riff, which is just so big. They go through a verse and some choruses. And when they come into the solo section, we have a really strong solo from Lord, and with great accompaniment behind him. Band is tight and supportive. And I think it sounds really great. And then Blackmore takes his turn, and my gosh, this is just, you know, catnip to me, as I'm a cat, because this is just, I love how thick and just nasty and gnarly it is. And, you know, he does something he doesn't usually do. He comes to this section of the solo and he just fires off this open low E and just lets it hang while the band is just thundering over it. And he restates it again with a nice syncopated and just lets it hang. And I'm like, ooh, goosebumps. There goes the hair. And I think that's really cool. It drives till the end, and where we get a laugh from Gillan and a nice thunderous little drum thump from Pacey, and the song's over. It's an unusual composition. I can't get past how heavy it is from an enjoyment standpoint. And the vocals worked, and Gillan just sounds aggressive and raw on it. And I love the track.
No, thanks, Pete. Well, as usual, I've got a little bit of a different take on it. I think it's a little bit sluggish, a little bit underbaked. It sounds like Midtown Tunnel Vision by Rainbow. So there's a bit of a recycled riff in regards to it. And the shakers are out. So again, to me, it's sort of like there's not enough groove in this song. We've got to put a little bit of a faux groove to have a little bit of a kick along. So I'm not totally sold on this particular track. I think I was getting a little bit fatigued in this album. Right. It's track 8. It's too long, this album. And I really think instead of doing 10 was kind of the minimum in the CD age, Pete. And in the album age, a Deep Purple album, 7 or 8 tracks, right, 34, 40 minutes, that's just direct to the point. But the CD age, it sort of stretches it out. And I think there are a lot of bands that have the tendency to just go over and take it too far. But anyway, this song, it's not one of my favorites because, yeah, I just couldn't get out of my head that it sounds like Midtown Tunnel Vision. I'm not sure. Anyway. Okay, Pete, so we get to track 9, which is Solitaire. A very different sounding Deep Purple track, I might add. Pete, what do you think of this song?
Are you reading my notes from there, Peter? It says a very different feel and tone on this track versus everything else on here. You know, you had mentioned, you know, on the previous track, the length and everything. I would have kind of been perfectly happy if the album had ended on track 8. And these two will probably reflect that as I go through it. This is a continuation of that disconnect for me because I think the music is really well played here. It's got some tension and release. It's got that Mideastern kind of edge to it. But man, the treatment on Gillan's vocals is just not something I enjoy. It just doesn't. And the halftime in the chorus is a nice touch, although they need to be careful to not use it too often as it becomes predictable. But a great organ solo from John. So here, musically, this was a hit, but vocally, this is a huge miss. You know, it just, you know, door, don't close the door. I'm like, really? That's really not something you can wrap your arms around with and walk down the street whistling, you know? So it really kind of needed a whole new set of melodic contributions from the vocal standpoint. When we wrap up, that'll kind of be something I strongly harbor on, but no, it's not the strongest track on here.
Well, it seems to be the theme of the show so far is that we're kind of opposites. I actually really like this song, and I don't mind the vocal, but it's one of those things I can't really explain. It has dark, elegant melodies. Mm-hmm. It's something completely different, and I love it that John Lord not only gets one solo, he gets two solos.
Yes.
So, you know, we're starting the winds in the sails of the Deep Purple machine right at the tail end of the album, and you're starting to get a bit more Lordy, a little bit more of the Hammond coming in. John Lord is the hero. There's no guitar solo. So, but yeah, look, there's sort of like that slightly Eastern type of feel to the song. It's a little bit darker. The lyrics are, you know, more introspective. It's a little bit more experimental, whereas the rest of the material is very much classic rock, mining a lot of the riffs and, you know, sticking relatively to the rules of hard rock and classic rock of the 70s, et cetera, and maybe just updating it a little bit sonically.
Sure.
Solitaire, it's definitely an outrider. It just sounds completely different.
It does. Absolutely.
Yes. All right. And then number 10, which is Joe Lynn Turner's favorite album track. Just jokes, Joe. One That's Man's right. Meat.
Well, it's probably been much more to the point where I disagree with a lot of things that Mr. Turner has to say. But in this case, he couldn't be more spot on. You know, it starts and it's got a clear LA connection, Run with the Wolf kind of beginning, excuse me, which is very encouraging because obviously two really well-constructed and songs that I love from that era of Rainbow. And it feels promising until Gillan opens his mouth and it's just like, these are awful. And I don't use that word ever with Ian Gillan. They're awful. You know, these lyrics are terrible. You know, I don't care for the double tracking. It's sometimes hit or miss, but this one's a huge thumbs down. And seriously, you pick any singer that you love in any genre, you give them the lyric One Man's Meat, you're not going to get something very good. You're just not. It's awful. You know, it's screaming for a better melody and a much better vocal performance and certainly either a different song title. You know, the instrumental interlude in this, which sadly is kind of negated by how bad it is around it. You know, Blackmore's solo is straight out of Long Live Rock and Roll era. I mean, it's gorgeous. I love it. And here again, at the very end, here comes harmonica and it fades out. What was the point of that? I mean, it had no elemental purpose in the track. It just is just something to throw in there. Why don't you do a car horn or something? I just, you know, it just seems so irrelevant to me. And this is not a good way to finish a track. And it is not a good way to finish an album on a high note.
Yeah.
This is a bad track.
I'll put a controversial view out here. I think Deep Purple had better opener tracks than closer tracks.
They didn't often close well.
No, I'm thinking about it, other than Space Trucking, which is just...
Well, I mean, Hard Lovin' Man ends
yeah
in rock.
Yeah, but I'm thinking of Perfect Strangers. I'm thinking of some of their other albums. No. You know, even Burn A. What is it? 200?
200. Yeah.
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 Fun track, but bit of a throwaway. They don't seem to pay as much attention to how we open the album as how we close it. To me, this sounds like a shuffle. Wow, man's me. You know, it's just sort of, I don't know. It just doesn't seem that they don't seem to have put a lot of energy and thought in this. And you can tell, and this is prevalent in the works of Rainbow, you can tell the songs that they have taken a bit more time, preparation, planned it out, comparative to the songs where they're a little bit more throwaway and come from a jam. They're not as compelling. This one sounds like there wasn't a lot of thought. It's a bit of a throwaway. And,
you know,
I mean, when you play, sorry, Pete, when you're playing the album, what's the last thing that you know, when the needle is taken out of the groove or you take the CD out, it's the last song that emulates in your head.
Well, it's no different than a dessert, Peter. When you go out to dinner, you could have the greatest appetizer. The entree is spectacular. You get your dessert and it sucks. You go home disappointed.
Yes.
You can't help it, no matter how good everything was ahead of it. Yeah. And it's so interesting when we look at it, especially in the album era. Let's just use 8 tracks, 4 and 4 on each side. There's always seems to be, you know, tracks 6 and 7 and a lot of times 8 are always so hit or miss. Certain albums, they work great. Yeah. Other albums, you're like, okay, I was done on track 5. And some of them front load. Maybe that just becomes out of popularity. Some you have to discover later. You know, great examples. I mean, Moving Pictures, for a long time, there's a whole lot of people who never even turned it over to side two because they were so smitten with side one, they just kept replaying it.
Yes.
Side two of Zeppelin 4, which is why that side of the album isn't overplayed on public airwaves because everything is on side one.
Yeah.
And it's interesting because you get a longer album like this. There is more of a responsibility to make sure that those later tracks, and it's catch 22, Peter, because in an album this long, if the attention span of the listening public isn't there, you put a great track down on 8 or 9 or 9 or 10, no one listens to it because they don't get that far. So if you put a bad track late, people go, okay, well, we usually don't get that far anyway, so we're just putting it there for those who have endured the endeavor and gotten all the way to the end.
Yeah.
So you're kind of stuck. Absolutely.
Yep, absolutely. So, all right. Well, thank you, Pete. We've gone through the tracks. I think the viewers have got a bit of a semblance of our views on this album.
Want me to rate this one?
Yeah. So over to you with your final thoughts with this album, Pete.
You know, this is an extremely frustrating record. But, and I'm going to liken it to another album. First of all, I'll just throw my rating out there and then everybody head scratch and they'll be like, whatever. This is my 9th favorite of the studio records. I have this in the 9th spot. And to be fair, I'm still working my rankings in on all of the Morris era stuff. So this is mostly everything up through this kind of point. So I give it a 7 out of 10, which seems like kind of high based on a lot of the things that I said. But here's what I did with this record. I have absolutely split my brain and compartmentalized things the exact same way I do when I listen to Abigail by King Diamond. I'm not a fan of King Diamond's vocals, but my God, I could listen to the band play forever. It is just, this is simply one of those cases. I could listen to this instrumentally all day. and just let Richie and John just rip off stuff in that huge sonic wall that they've created here. And I kind of, in a sense, almost kind of block or shade out Gillan's offensive spots, listen to it where it's less offensive, and I enjoy the record. It's a strange way to do it, but you know what? That's how it turned out. And I gave up a long time ago. You know, I've had three previous records. There is no going back to 1973 with this lineup. It was never going to happen. The time is gone. The moods are gone. The feeling's gone. And I have to be fly on the wall here. Did they all get a sense, especially the two main characters, that, okay, yeah, I'm back in here. This is not going to last as far as the ink on the paper we signed to start this thing. It was, the grenade is already in the room. It's just a question how quick somebody pulls the bloody pin. Because it's just not going to work. And I will say, to his credit, and especially on the live, you know, Come Hell or High Water DVD that's out there of this tour, personalities notwithstanding, when Richie decides to play, he plays. And he plays with ferocity and a fierce, scorching attitude. And the music wins because of that. But nothing could have felt good about this. Nothing. So I compartmentalize it. It's got asterisks all over it. But there it is.
Yep. All right. Well, bit to unpack here. I'm not a big fan of this album, and I think it's probably one of my least favorite Deep Purple albums. So it's right probably at the bottom. Near the bottom of the whole discography. Sure. What I don't like about it is that I don't like the sound. I don't like the way it's produced. It's a very loud, sort of alternative rock type of mix. Doesn't have the warm analog, as I said at the start. I think the songwriting's a little bit tired. It recycles a lot of riffs. I know they're recycling within, but by 1993... to celebrate their 25th year, you think they could have brought something out of the bag. Now, Gillan coming back into the band, I related to like a divorce. Now, it's like you've got a relationship, two people. They may have had an attraction at the start. They're warring. They tolerate each other, but they stay together for the sake of the kids because they know that there's sort of like a lot of creativity. There's something good that they're producing. They fall out, you know, and then they start to reminisce. Wouldn't it be good to get back together? They get back. They talk about old times, share a cup of coffee. Everything's all warm and fuzzy. And then the wounds start to come. Remember this, remember that, and all the habits and bad things that made that relationship to start off with start to come to the fore. They fall out again. Then the kids say, you've got to come back just for the sake of one happy family. You know, we had something going good. And they come back, but the magic's gone. The lemon has been squeezed dry. And that's what I feel about this album. I feel that they tried to bring the family back together, but creatively speaking, the lemon's dry. It just sounds forced. It sounds not organic, not natural. It sounds like it's, dare I say, a little bit contrived. And look, I really feel sorry for Gillan because he's been put in a no-win situation. He's been given arrangements that are not comfortable with him. He's been given keys that he can't sing. He's trying all these different things and they're trying to see if things stick and it just doesn't quite fit there. One thing, Pete, and I know we're just going a little tangent before I wrap up.
Sure.
With Blackmore solos and melodies, you can sort of hum them. I can sort of think of Smoke in the Water, lead break, burn, lead break. I can't remember any of the lead breaks on this album. And, you know, That's really for a Blackmore Deep Purple album. That's kind of major. There's no lead breaks in my head, in my you know, that my consciousness that I can really remember.
I think if, and see if you agree, Richie, when he solos, lives in one of three worlds. His first world is where he comes out and is so melodic, it's an additional vocal line. You can sing it, you can feel it, you can hum it, you can walk around it, and it is in your head. The second is where the technical Richie comes out. The fluidity and the chops and the runs and the vibrato and all the, you know, he uses a ton of vibrato on the first section. I'm not saying he doesn't, but it's more of a kind of a pyrotechnic kind of delivery. His third is when he just doesn't give a crap and he just picks slides and makes noises and rubs his hands along the,
yeah,
you know, and then dive bombs and everything else. That's
rhythm
when
guitar. Yeah.
That's when he's just frustrated and just doesn't want to give you anything.
Yeah.
This album, I feel, lives almost exclusively in that second phase. There are little elements here and there, like I mentioned, you know, some stuff from Long Live and sections like that, but they don't last. And it's, I don't want to say technique's sake for technique's sake, but a lot of times when you play angry, that's kind of where you go to. And if we can presume that things were not all rosy and cozy in the studio, that maybe this was a bit of him just saying, yeah, I'm going to put down what I want to put down the way I want to put it down. And
yeah,
if it kind of works, it does, you know, I mean, we don't know, but you're correct from your original analysis that no, there's not much
left in the tank.
Yeah, that you would take with you. You know, and if the proof is, you know, are they done? Are they completely done? Well, no, because we can hear the lightness and the removal of all of the weight and the stress and the conflict as soon as you hear the opening of Ted the Mechanic on Perpendicular. It's like floating. You're like,
yep,
they're all so much happier and they're like so much lighter. Richie, as I mentioned, carries over some of this type of songwriting, although he's got a lot of Rainbow's first album stuff done at a more intense level, also in Stranger in Us All. So that's a kind of a hybrid, but Richie takes that with him over to Rainbow, and that's where the thickness, and of course that band didn't last either.
Yeah. I mean,
so we all know who the culprit is. It's never been a surprise.
Yes.
You know, Blackie's is the troublemaker.
Absolutely. And I think, as I said, friction can produce great art, but sometimes fatigue comes in and it's not so great art. And that's where I think this album for me lies. Right. But anyway, yeah.
makes perfect sense. And it's not a, you know, outside thoughts, what they are. It's not a overall well-received record collectively. You know, and it's just sometimes there's, you know, look, a Kiss fan like me would look at somebody who really enjoys, let's say, The Elder, for an example, and kudos to you if you love The Elder. I have no problem if you love The Elder. I just look at it and go, I don't know how you can listen to that versus this. That's just my own inability to rationalize it, that, you know, it just seems odd that there's this weird album that kind of sits in this little isolated island because they were in a different place before and they were sure as heck in a different place after it.
Yep.
That connects on what weird level it connects on. And you're
absolutely
like, okay, it's strange,
yeah,
but that's how it works. So,
yeah.
Pete, as Judas Priest said, you deliver the goods. Thank you, my friend. This was a really enjoyable discussion. And folks, there's going to be plenty more on the Purple Family Tree on Rock Daydream Nation. It's such a rewarding and vast rock family. A lot of good things that we'll be talking about during 2024. So you can see Pete Jones on the Contrarians. Just type in the word Pete Jones, the Contrarians. You'll see all of his shows. Please like and subscribe to Rock Daydream Nation. Click the bell because you'll hear when the new shows are up straight away. Tell us what you think about this album, your favorite songs, your least favorite songs, or, you know, what you think of the album in general. But one thing's for certain, you'll see me and Pete talking about rock in 2024. Cheers. See ya.
Cheers.